and my absence, I am confident, though I've started listening to the service, we have not got quite to the sermon yet, but I am confident she did an outstanding job because she always does. Then I want to call your attention to the order form for Poinsettias that's in your bulletin. Our Christmas mailbox for cards to church members is now in the narthex. I forgot all about that before I left the country last week, so I didn't put it out. I apologize for any inconvenience. Then the small group Bible study and fellowship will meet this evening at the home of Doug and Mary Wegman, and everyone that is asked to bring their favorite appetizer or dessert. Then the Friendship Club will gather this Wednesday at 11 o'clock for a Dutch Street lunch at the Chop House there in Franklin Square. Then I also want to remind you that our annual Christmas giving opportunities are upon us, whatever it is, they're here. Out in the narthex, you'll find the midden trees, and there's fish hospitality cards. I think the angels and the gifts of the angel tree and the items for volunteer ministry center are due next Sunday, so that you can bring those by then. That makes it easier to distribute. Thank you for that and your generosity year after year. With all that said, let us now prepare our hearts to worship the risen Jesus.
Thank you. number 278, Angels We Have Heard on High, and we'll follow that with the chorus, Emmanuel.
Thank you. says, "And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger.' And suddenly there was the angel, a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.'"
Let us pray. Father God, thank you for the many blessings that you bestow on us from day to day, but especially thank you for blessing us with your Son. The birth of him, along with the joy that we have in knowing you, in loving you, in following you, and having faith in you, we know no bounds. We pray that you just be with us in this Christmas season, and that we know the true joy of the blessing that you have given to us, Christ Jesus. For these things we pray in your most heavenly and precious name. Amen.
If you will take your bulletin while you're remaining standing and flip to the inside cover, we will do our Advent responsive reading. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor.
He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted,
to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners,
to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor,
to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve,
to bestow on them a crown of
the oil of gladness instead of mourning,
and the garment of praise instead of the spirit of despair.
They will be called oaks of righteousness,
a planting of the Lord with the display of his splendor.
Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion.
Great is the Holy One of Israel among you.
Thank you. You may be seated, and if you do so, join me in this time of prayer. Claim that promise in Scripture this day, that the blood offer the prayers of our hearts. And Lord, there's many folks on our prayer list, but there's other folks on our hearts and minds that are struggling this time of year. Christmas is a joyful time for many, but it's a sad time for a lot of folks. The first Christmas without a loved one, Christmas can remind them of how lonely they really are. The pressures in our culture to buy and spend that which we cannot afford. There's a lot of things about this season that disturb us, Father. So I'm asking that your Spirit give us some relief, that you allow us to realize we're not alone, and it's not about the money we spend on presents, but it's about loving you, loving our family, and loving our brothers and sisters in Christ. So we lift up not only those that are struggling in this season, we lift up those, Father, who are struggling, whatever the struggle may be, whether it's health or injury, whether it's relationships, whatever that struggle may be, Father, we lift them up, and we know that your grace is sufficient to meet their needs. So we just ask that you flood your grace into their lives, into our lives, so that we can find our needs met and give you the praise and the glory. Now, if you would, please join me in the word of prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, forever. Amen. morning is found in Paul's letter to the 2 Corinthians, where he simply writes, "Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift." Let us now honor God through our giving.
Thank you.
sow more into our lives than we're even aware. That you're consistent, and you're faithful, and you're abundantly generous, and we praise you for that. And Father, I praise you for the faithfulness and generosity of these your people gathered here in your house this day. They have proven over and over and over again that they want to be like Jesus, that they want to be faithful and generous, and you've allowed them to do so. So Lord, I ask that you take the gifts that have come in this week through the offering plate or through the mail or online, that you take those gifts and you magnify them so that there is enough to accomplish everything you would have us to do, and enough to do even more, the things we dare not even dream of. We thank you again in your holy name. You may be seated, and as you do so, I'm going to ask our children to come forward.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Look at this fine looking group today. I'm so excited for y'all to be here. Last week we had a craft sale, and I found some really cool stuff out there. I found this.
That one's cute.
Isn't it cute? It says it's not what's under the Christmas tree that matters, it's who's around it. Charlie Brown. Do y'all know who Charlie Brown is?
Yeah.
You do? Charlie Brown is, he's a good comic. And I'm going to tell you something. He has a book that he wrote. It's called A Charlie Brown's Christmas. Now, Charlie Brown didn't really write this. Charles Schulz wrote this. But it tells all about Christmas. And in this storybook, Charlie Brown is trying to figure out what Christmas is all about. And so he's looking for just the right tree. He's got to get the play has got to be just right. Everything's got to be just right. And poor old Charlie Brown can't do a thing right. He reminds me of me. He just messes everything up. Every time Charlie Brown tries to do something, Lucy's just like, can't you do anything right, Charlie Brown? Poor old Charlie Brown. Wouldn't you feel sad if somebody said that to you all the time? Well, he looks at his buddy Linus, and he says, Linus, just can't anybody tell me what Christmas is about? And Linus says, I can, Charlie Brown. He says, I can tell you what Christmas is about. Do you want to hear what he said?
Yeah.
Okay, turn your ears on because it's going to be kind of soft.
And there were, in the same country, shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring unto you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you this day is born in the city of Bethlehem a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
What did Linus say Christmas was all about? Jesus! That makes Christmas so special, doesn't it? Well, you know, Jesus got some presents. We'll talk about that in a little while. But we celebrate when Jesus came to earth because he loved us so much. He was born. Have y'all ever been in a stable or a barn? It's kind of smelly and kind of dirty. And Jesus came from heaven down to a smelly, dirty old stable. That's kind of cool, isn't it? Just because he loved us. So today, our candle was the joy candle, and we should have joy, shouldn't we? Because Jesus came.
Yeah.
Yes. So let's have a prayer, and then we're going to go back into the classroom and do something a little special today, okay? All right. Here we go. Let's have a prayer. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, with our hearts filled with joy, thanking you, Lord, that you did send your only Son into the world. Just as the shepherds were filled with joy as they saw the star, Lord, we ask that you fill our hearts with joy when we look at our tree and we see those twinkling lights. May it remind us of the stars that were in the sky. Bless us, Lord, as we go through the remainder of this Advent season. Help us to have a heart that's giving and joyful. In your name we pray these things. Amen.
Stand and turn your hymnals to 247. You may not even need the hymnal. Let us worship and adore him.
Morning. I do not want to take up our time talking about my trip to Guatemala last week, but I want to give you a heads up and then tell you how blessed you are as a congregation. I'll give you the blessing part first. You see, when I was preaching in Guatemala last week, they had to listen to me and an interpreter, and sermons were twice as long. So you are indeed blessed. But what I really want to do is give you a heads up. In the upcoming edition of the Cumberlander that hopefully will be mailed out tomorrow, in that edition, with the approval of our session, I'm going to be making a fundraising appeal to help a sister congregation in Guatemala City. It just so happens to be the congregation I preached at last Sunday. So I'll just give you a little bit of heads up, and then I'm going to move on into the message. Several years ago, Barna Research Group conducted a poll and found that only 37% of American adults, 37%, now this is several years ago, I'm willing to bet the number is lower today, but they found that only 37% of American adults believe that the birth of Jesus is the most important aspect of Christmas. Obviously, they never read Charles Schulz's book and listened to Linus. By the way, Charles Schulz, we know him as a cartoonist, but he may be America's greatest theologian. you, but I was sort of surprised when I read that number, 37%. So to verify the polls, though, I ask that you think about the Christmas decorations in the neighborhood in which you live, the streets you drove down this morning. If your community is anything like my subdivision, you can look at the vast majority of the decorations and discover that they have nothing at all to do with Jesus. And they smoke in and they drink in and they're Santa Claus and sleighs. I'm not talking against any of those things. But in most homes, Jesus falls way below those things. Which causes me to ask this question, and it's the title of today's message. What should Christmas look like? Now, I'm not talking about what decorations you should have in your yard, even though I just mentioned decorations, but the question is pretty simple. What should Christmas look like? As I thought about that question, my initial response was to look back to some Norman Rockwell Christmas paintings. You know those paintings I'm talking about, do you not? With all the snow and the family. Well, these paintings are filled with nostalgia, and they make my heart feel good and warm. They do not reflect reality as much as they idealize memories of a time that never was. You catch that phrase? Memories of a time that never was. That's what nostalgia does to us from time to time. Unlike Bing Crosby, most people I know are not dreaming of a white Christmas, though we had one last year. Instead, they are dreaming of a perfect Christmas, sort of like Charlie Brown looking for that perfect tree. They're dreaming of a perfect Christmas, one in which the whole family is gathered around the tree, one in which everyone gets the gifts they desire, one in which everyone is healthy. The perfect Christmas. Like Norman Rockwell, we tend to long for a time that never will be. That is because so many people confuse joy and happiness. Joy and happiness. They don't seem to be able to separate them, and they're confused. And this confusion causes us to think that if we could just experience that perfect Christmas, then we would truly be happy. Notice that the Collins family did not light the happy candle this morning. Instead, they lit the joy candle in honor of the birth of Christ our Savior, in honor of the one who gives us true joy in spite of our circumstances. Circumstances typically dictate our happiness, but they should not dictate our joy. And we celebrate the one today who gives us true joy in spite of our circumstances. When I was first discovering the Advent wreath some 35 years ago, I didn't grow up with that either at home or in the church I was a part of. But when I first discovered the Advent wreath, today's candle was typically called the Shepherd's Candle. Some of you all may remember when it was called that. You had the wise man candle and the Bethlehem candle and so on. But it was called the Shepherd's Candle because they were the ones to whom the angel announced the joyous news of Christ's birth. In recognition of Rebecca's sermon titled last week, I almost entitled today's message, The Nativity from the Shepherd's Perspective, but I did not. Because I want us to focus on the question, what should Christmas look like? With all that said, I'm going to ask you to please rise in body or spirit in honor of God's word. It's recorded in Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. And though part of this text was read by Logan at the beginning of the text, and part of it, the beginning of the service, part of it was read by Linus during the children's message, I want to read the text in its entirety. Luke writes, in that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news. praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those who favor. When the angels had left him and gone into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these things, all these words, and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. The word of God. Father, we come before you again. We lift up your holy name. And we ask that you help us understand what Christmas should look like. That it should be a joyous time. A time where we celebrate our salvation. Celebrate our Savior. And share with others the good news. In your holy name I do pray. You may be seated. Though I'm not going to share about my recent trip to Guatemala this morning, I want to back up about 25 years, and I want to talk about a recently divorced single mom in Birmingham, Alabama. Now, this mom belonged to a Cumberland Presbyterian congregation there. She was also a registered nurse, not a shepherd, but a registered nurse. She had a preteen daughter. She did not go to Guatemala because an angel told her to go. Instead, she went desperately looking for a new start in life. We'll go a lot of places looking for a new start, will we not? She went desperately looking for a new start. That new start took the form of being a nurse taking care of not a newborn baby, but dozens of kids at a children's. Now, after being at that children's home for a couple of years, she moved to another children's home. And there, she felt God encouraging her to do something. Not merely try to nurse these kids and filth that they had. But this children's home did not have a medical clinic. And she felt God urging her to build a medical clinic. Now there's a couple of difficulties here. First of all, she's a nurse, not a builder. She don't know how to build a clinic. Then she's also from the States, not Guatemala. She don't know the red tape she has to go to. And then there's this little thing called, how in the world can I afford to build a medical clinic? All of those things together made this seem like an impossible task. Now, I want you to notice this. It's in that move from two children's homes and the building of the clinic that she realized that God had called her to Guatemala. Not through the voice of an angel, but through the circumstances of her life. Let me interrupt this story to say this is how God typically calls people. Through the circumstances of our lives. Very seldom are you going to hear a voice boom from heaven like Noah or Abraham. Very seldom will any human hear a voice of an angel say they shall call his name Jesus. It's okay, Joseph. It's okay. Instead, God calls us through the circumstances of life. That means he puts us places sometimes we don't want to be so that we can realize how much we need him. She didn't really want to go to Guatemala. She just wanted to get away from an abusive ex-husband, and this was a chance. hey, and I get to see a foreign country too. She started the process of figuring out how to build the medical clinic, and then she realized that God had called her there. And it very quickly, she shared that with that second children's home, it very quickly became her responsibility to build the clinic. So to make this happen, she appealed to her Cumberland Presbyterian congregation back in Birmingham, and a miracle occurred. It was not the birth of a newborn baby, and as far as I know, no swaddling clothes were involved in this miracle at all. But it was the birth of a medical clinic, and unbeknownst to anyone involved at the time, it was the birth of the Cumberland Presbyterian Church in Guatemala. Now, I was privileged to both give financially to this project, and I led one of the American Mission work teams that built the medical clinic. In fact, I led the last team there. They got everything ready for them to minister medically to children. And by the way, this particular children's home and its then new medical clinic, now 18 years ago, this particular children's home and its medical clinic more closely resembled the stable in Bethlehem than it did any children's ministry or doctor's office we would be familiar with. You see, sometimes we think if it's not first class, if it's not gold laden, God can't use it. But God can use anything we get to Him. Anything. So again, I'm finally back to the original question. What should Christmas look like? What should Christmas look like? May I suggest that all these centuries later, Christmas should look like what happened in Bethlehem, possibly 2,000 years ago. To understand what I'm suggesting, we have to slip away from the shopping mall, stand back from our multitasking, turn off our favorite multimedia devices. Surprised I didn't hear a grunt or two when I said that. And that's not just young people. Our old people are just as addicted as our kids ever thought about being. That's another story. We have to slip away from the shopping mall, stand back from our multitasking, turn off our favorite media devices, and control our appetites. My favorite part of Christmas is the meals, right? Have to control our appetites long enough to go over to Bethlehem, at least in our minds, to see what Christmas looks like. Are you there yet? Are you in Bethlehem? If so, consider the shepherds who are keeping watch over their flock by night. They are minding their own business. That night does not look much different than any other night. But keep looking. God breaks in and speaks to them through an angel. Now, God still breaks into our lives. More often through circumstances, it is and speaks to us. It is often, though, through the words of a pastor or a teacher or a friend or a parent or a child. He interrupts whatever it is we're doing to speak to us. And in this case, an angel speaks to the shepherd. And their first reaction is fear. I think that would be my reaction too, if I heard an angel speak. But that reaction was quickly followed by reverent attention. They clung to the angel's every word. Now, what strikes me about this encounter with God's messenger is that the angel does not give the shepherds specific instructions. Reread the story. He didn't tell them exactly what to do. He does not push them to go into town or threaten them if they do not. And he didn't promise any material reward for going. Yep, if you just go over to Bethlehem, see that baby, all your financial needs are going to be set. You're going to be healthy, wealthy, and wise forever. The angel said nothing like that. The shepherds do not have a star to follow as the wise men will later in the story. Nor do they have some kind of escort angel to lead them to the right place. The angel simply says, "This will be a sign for you. You will find the child wrapped in bands of cloth, lying in a manger." You will find implies that they will seek. You don't find without seeking. The story of Charlie Brown. He's seeking the meaning of Christmas. And Linus takes him to our text for today and to the shepherds. You find when you seek. Christmas should look like that scene there in Bethlehem some 2,000 years ago. And I'm not just talking about the familiar stable and the manger. I'm not just talking about Mary, Joseph, and baby Jesus and a few farm animals. What I'm trying to say this morning is Christmas should look like those shepherds making major adjustments in their lives in order to seek Jesus so that they could join him, join God in what he is doing. Uh-oh, making major adjustments in our lives. Preacher, you lost me. I just want to add Jesus and be blessed. I don't want to change anything. You don't want to celebrate Christmas. You just want to exchange gifts. Have a good meal or two. If you want to celebrate Christmas, if you want to truly celebrate Christmas, then you allow God to break into your life and make changes in your life. My friend from Birmingham made such a major adjustment in her life. She went down there, unbeknownst that God was sending her, only to learn later she did. But she made a major change. She didn't know Spanish. And yet there she was. She loved children. She was a good nurse. There she was. Again, my friend made a major adjustment in her life. And hear this. God is constantly calling us to do the same in our lives. God is constantly calling us to make adjustments. Why? Well, because sometimes we've wandered off the path and we need to come back. Sometimes we may even be doing good things, but not what he's calling us to do. God is constantly calling us to make major adjustments. Now, God may not send us to either Bethlehem or Guatemala, but he will send us somewhere. Now, don't let that scare you. I don't mean he might send you to Russia or somewhere in Africa or China, but he will send us somewhere. It may be to elderly people's home to do long-neglected yard work. It may be to the store, buy items for the angel tree or the mitten tree. It may be to the next room or even across the church aisle to tell someone we are sorry or to say we love them. It may be somewhere we cannot even imagine yet. But God is constantly calling his children to join him in what he's doing. To join him.
Yeah.
My dad, on Saturday mornings, unlike most of my teenage friends, he did not allow me to sleep in. He called me pretty early because we had a task to do for that day. Whether it was plant the garden, weed the garden, or harvest in the garden, whether it was to go to the hay field, whether it was to mow the yard, he had a task. I wanted to sleep. I wanted to be like my buddies, get up at noon and go to the pool. My dad had a job for me to do. Our father has a job for us to do too. We like to sit on the sidelines. We're content just to sit in the pew, but God's calling us to do much more than we do in this building, much more than we do in this room. Yes, he calls us to worship him. He wants us to gather into fellowship and to grow, to together so that we can go out in this world and do whatever he's calling us to do. It may be go to Bethlehem or Guatemala, or it may be go to a neighbor's house or speak to a co-worker or a classmate. He's calling his children to join him in what he is doing. We most probably will never hear the voice of an angel, but we will feel the divine tug on our heart. You know what I'm talking about, do you not? If you've never felt the divine tug, you're not a child. You need to make that right today. Because he's constantly tugging on the children's heart. My heart felt such a tug last week. You'll get to read about it this coming week's newsletter. On two occasions, I've had the privilege to travel to Bethlehem, and I visited the shrine there that has been erected where the birth of Jesus most likely took place. And I wish I had the ability to describe how visiting such a holy place touched my heart, but my description would fall woefully short. Master Cato, though, in his book, The Applause of Heaven, puts it like this. A small cathedral outside of Bethlehem marks the supposed birthplace of Jesus. Behind a high altar in the church is a cave, a little cavern lit by silver lamps. You can enter the main edifice and admire the ancient church. You can also enter the quiet cave where a star embedded in the floor recognizes the birth of the king. There is one stipulation, however. You have to stoop. The door is so low that you cannot go in standing up. You have to stoop. The same is true of Christ. You can see the world standing tall, but to witness the Savior, you have to get on your knees. The night when Jesus was born, while theologians were sleeping and the elite were dreaming and the successful were snoring, the meek shepherds were kneeling. They were kneeling before the one only the meek will see. They were kneeling in front of Jesus. In closing, I want to ask you a very personal question. Have you ever knelt for Jesus? Notice I did not ask if you ever been baptized. Notice I also did not ask if you ever walked an aisle and talked to a preacher and muttered some prayer he told you to repeat. I simply ask, have you ever knelt before Jesus? If not, then you do not truly know what Christmas should look like. But the good news is, that you can know this very hour if you do like the shepherds and seek him. For when you find Jesus, you will kneel. Eventually, the whole world will kneel. Let us pray together. Father, we come before you one more time today, and we thank you for your word. We thank you for your love, your grace. We thank you for your joy. Father, may this day, everyone here, may they be assured in their heart that they have knelt before the Savior. And if not, may they kneel this very day so that it will never be an issue again. In your holy and glorious name, I do pray.
You'll stand and take your hymnals and turn to 259, Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Thank you.
Christmas musical, Mary Did You Know? And I encourage you to be here, watch me mess up three or four songs, and hear Karen's face turn red when I mess up. But I do encourage you to be here. It's a wonderful time to bring friends and family that don't normally attend, and I won't even